The mission of Glacial Lakes Conservancy is to permanently preserve and protect land water resources for future generations. As one of the approximately 40 land trusts in Wisconsin and about 1,700 in the U.S., GLC envisions a legacy of permanently protected lands and land use policies that sustain and enhance a regional quality of life defined by the beauty and productivity of its working lands and natural resources. Glacial Lakes Conservancy offers land conservation options, organizational support, and technical guidance to landowners and organizations in a 5-county region of Wisconsin: Sheboygan, Manitowoc, Kewaunee, Calumet, and Fond du Lac. Most often, Glacial Lakes Conservancy partners with willing private landowners to develop conservation easement agreements, which leave land in private ownership while limiting development and protecting important conservation values. GLC currently holds 26 conservation easements for private owners. GLC also raises funds to purchase land outright. Today, because of the generosity of members, donors, and volunteers, GLC owns 5 properties: William F. Crystal Woods and Wetlands Preserve, Grasshopper Hill Preserve, Charles and Winifred Spring West Twin River Preserve, Willow Creek Preserve, and the Hunter Preserve. GLC-owned properties are always open to the public and ensure everyone can enjoy access to the wonder and beauty of nature. The mission of Glacial Lakes Conservancy is to permanently preserve and protect land water resources for future generations. As one of the approximately 40 land trusts in Wisconsin and about 1,700 in the U.S., GLC envisions a legacy of permanently protected lands and land use policies that sustain and enhance a regional quality of life defined by the beauty and productivity of its working lands and natural resources. Glacial Lakes Conservancy offers land conservation options, organizational support, and technical guidance to landowners and organizations in a 5-county region of Wisconsin: Sheboygan, Manitowoc, Kewaunee, Calumet, and Fond du Lac. Most often, Glacial Lakes Conservancy partners with willing private landowners to develop conservation easement agreements, which leave land in private ownership while limiting development and protecting important conservation values. GLC currently holds 26 conservation easements for private owners. GLC also raises funds to purchase land outright. Today, because of the generosity of members, donors, and volunteers, GLC owns 5 properties: William F. Crystal Woods and Wetlands Preserve, Grasshopper Hill Preserve, Charles and Winifred Spring West Twin River Preserve, Willow Creek Preserve, and the Hunter Preserve. GLC-owned properties are always open to the public and ensure everyone can enjoy access to the wonder and beauty of nature.
Well, hi, everybody. And by everybody, I mean, I think those of us who are sitting here playing this game together. Hi.
Hi.
And and bots, we were talking to your big brother, ChatGPT, just now. And he just told us the most delightful story.
He said, invite more bots, because we don't have anybody else who watches.
That's right. We need some more bots to watch. But in any case, tonight we are continuing Masks of Nyarlathotep. Hotep. Our investigators are in East Africa, in the capital city of Kenya, the Kenyan colony at the time, of Nairobi, and have spent the day, and here's where I'm going to really rely on the investigators here to fill in the gaps. We haven't played in a long time. They spent the day going to, I think they went to the library. There was some shopping for some, I want to say some items were purchased. And then I think that they realized they were being tailed, and Clyde did what Clyde does, which was tail the tail. And they ended up having a delightful conversation where they sort of out-mercenaried each other for a while and respectfully parted ways, I believe is what happened at the end of that. I want to say you spoke to a British functionary, and I cannot remember which British, because there's several you can speak to, and I don't remember which British functionary that you spoke to.
Roger Corydon.
Okay, Roger Corydon. Who you spoke to.
Oh yeah, I do remember the conversation about how 50% of that person's body was burned, because you gave a very precise percentage.
That's right.
And that part I remember.
I also remember part of that. I'm going to mute now.
Oh no. I think
I just made myself laugh all over again.
Well, that's the good thing about not playing for a while. The joke just is like brand new.
if you hadn't said a half, I never would have I wouldn't have remembered.
You're just the left half.
Just anyway, I don't remember what other information he gave you. It seems to me that I may have forgotten to give you something that he would have referred you to the King's African Rifles, because they keep their own records, and perhaps they could help you with the investigation, and so he would have made that referral for you. If I did not make that,
what? No, that doesn't sound familiar. What
okay,
was that?
He should have made a referral to the King's African Rifles. Sort of, I think it would be like the equivalent of the French Foreign Legion in Kenya, but except they're probably British citizens, Expeditionary Force, I guess. And this would be 1925, so yeah, that would still be true. So so yeah, they would be a place that you could also find their he would be able to tell you that they're located at Fort Smith. Excuse me, just swallowed incorrectly. And it was a potato chip. Hold on.
Oof. Fort Smith, number 5 on our map.
Okay. Ah, there we go. So that is, I'm sorry for that, but I think I've now got it all retconned. And then after that is when you guys realized you were being tailed, and Clyde had the very polite conversation with the spy hitman person that he spoke with. So I think it was early evening where we left off, and or either that or you guys headed back to the hotel, and we were starting up the next day. And I will let you guys decide what you would prefer it to be. If you wanted to continue on with that evening or that afternoon's investigation, we can pick it up from there, or we can say it's the next day. I am comfortable with either.
Did we go to the Nairobi Star?
Not yet.
Not yet.
I believe okay. You've made it there.
Because I didn't think so either, because I that wrote was... that we were moving on to the Nairobi okay. Star. And then Clyde was looking for nails at the Victorian Bar, but was referred to the Loyal Defender.
Oh. That's right, the Loyal Defender.
So,
and that, I don't think
those were...
Okay, so Clyde
we didn't go
is
to
still...
either of those places yet.
Okay, so Clyde was going to go to the Loyal Defender, and you guys were going to go to the Nairobi Star.
That was Purdy who asked that question, not me. I was with
oh, I'm
the tail.
Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, I meant to say Purdy. I'm sorry. Okay. I said the wrong name.
Purdy was referred to the Loyal Defender. Okay.
So, I don't know. It's not like Purdy to go to a dive bar.
Fair. how do you guys want to... you are all split. Then I think then we're in four different parties, or three different parties. We got Clyde by himself, Purdy by himself, and then... Harmon.
Hey,
and...
no, I don't think we would do that.
Yeah, I don't think so either. So...
No, I'm not saying we split up. I'm just saying
okay.
that Purdy had gotten that information, yeah, about nails
gotcha.
Being at the pub, and that we had, as a group, talked about going to the Nairobi Star, but then we noticed we were being followed.
Gotcha. So... Okay. Perfect. I think we're all on the same page then. And so we'll say it's mid-afternoon or early afternoon at this point. And because you've really only been to the consulate, I think, then, to speak to Croydon at the government house. Yeah. So it wouldn't be a consulate because it's a colony. So there, then, yeah, you guys would have most of the day. So what would you like to do?
Well, I'm going to ask another stupid question.
Oh, it's probably not stupid.
Was Roger Corridan the one we talked to, or was he the one that was dead?
He is the one you talked to.
Well, it says Lieutenant Selkirk.
Lieutenant
Selkirk was
died.
Here. Okay.
Yep.
Oh, that's right.
Selkirk,
my cousin.
Yeah. Selkirk was mentioned in Elias's notes, and he has since passed.
That's right. Okay.
Yes,
I
that's
didn't
the
have
cousin.
Selkirk's first name down. So I was like, well, which one was I pretending was my cousin? So that makes sense. Okay, thank you.
Got
trying
it.
To just remember what I'm doing.
Yeah, it's been a minute. I'm trying to remember everything you guys have discovered and hopefully not give you the wrong picture again. So I just because I don't remember where we left off and don't remember exactly what happened, I don't have like a fun and exciting drop you right into the action. So I can say if you would like, it would be no trouble whatsoever to get to the Nairobi Star. It also wouldn't be too hard to find the Loyal Defender. But both are very doable goals, and both are very doable within the span of a day of the afternoon.
And our goal at the Star is to just look at other newspaper articles.
See if anything else came up on the Carlisle expedition.
Okay.
Well, you want to split up into twos? To go to the Star, to go to the bar? That should be good rhyme.
Pretty good. Get Kenny Loggins to write a song about it.
Especially if it's Kenny Loggins. So, I like I said, I'm not going to get caught up with anything as far as travel times or anything. So whatever one you guys want to do first, just let me know. And I will ask for how you're going to move and travel and what you're looking for on your way there. But otherwise, I'm not going to get into, like, it's 3 blocks or whatever. It's just whatever. So, it sounds like there will be Star first.
Sure. Are we concerned at all about being followed here? Or is this kind of like, well, people are watching us. We're just going to the newspaper.
I'm sorry, I said you guys all going to the Nairobi Star, but I also heard you guys talking about splitting up, so that's...
Oh, I thought you just meant who you were going to focus
on. Oh, yeah. First. Doesn't matter to me.
Well, I would say Daisy would be more likely to go to the newspaper office than the pub, so, especially the seedy pub. So I'm going for Team Star.
Okay. Team Nairobi Star. Who else is going to the Nairobi Star? Daisy's going.
I can go.
Birdie can't read, and he likes bars. So
I think that sums that decision making up.
I kind of assumed you were going to the pub. So.
All right. So is it? It's Clyde going with Daisy. Okay.
And I'll go with Purdy to the tavern.
To the tavern. Okay. When you get to the Star, it's Nairobi's an up-and-coming city. I think I described this the last time. It's not huge. It's not nearly as big as Mombasa was. Nowhere near the size of Cairo. But it's a growing metropolis, a growing city. And this is a moderately sized building, more modern, definitely European influence in the building. It says that the editor-in-chief, proprietress, is Mrs. Natalie Smythe Forbes. I will type that into the... Natalie Smythe Forbes. And she appears to be the only person, or at least you can make a somewhat of an assumption that it is Miss Forbes, because she's the only person in the building as you enter and the door hits a little bell, ding, 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 ding. And she's, hustling through the back offices, sort of assembling type. It's a modern for the 20s printing press, but still, you know, like, it's a clinker, and she's kind of working on it, getting it running, and is also like checking over some copy at the same time. And I'm sorry, can I help you? And she looks a little harried and busy.
Yeah, we're looking to see if we look through some old editions. We're gonna do a report on some local events.
Really, 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 really local events. Are you new to town?
Yeah, relatively.
And may I ask what brings you to Nairobi? And she introduces herself and does the handshakes and stuff, asks your names.
Well, I gives the appropriate disguise name that I don't remember at this current point in time.
Okay.
We'll say Carl. Carl's out to play.
Right.
I think we haven't really picked them, have we? I think this might be an important.
Yeah, maybe now is the time.
Maybe just tonight.
For
man, didn't give it any forethought.
Sure, why not? I am Isaac Clark. Pleasure to meet you.
Isaac?
I'm Isaac Clark.
Okay. Got it. Now I'm looking for your... So that I remember, I'm going to your name thing so that I can... Okay. And, yes, yeah, hello, and you are? Do you got one pick, Robin?
Yeah, I'm Violet.
Nice.
Violet, Espadrille.
Espadrille. All right.
You know, she says the first thing that comes to her mind.
Well, welcome. What brings you to Nairobi? And to come right to my paper, I'm wondering if do you have any news? Anything fit to print in Nairobi's finest newspaper?
Well, if we're being honest, I'm looking for more of the spookier side of things. If you know what I'm saying.
Wink, wink, nod, nod. I do. I also am interested in the supernatural. However, everything I've come across here has just been sort of, you know, explained away as tribal superstition. I have yet to see anything out of the ordinary, but I do hope to. Are you seeking out this sort of supernatural kind of experience?
One would say such things, yes.
My psychic back home sent us on this path, and I feel like we're going to hit something here.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you just do Merryweather?
No, okay. Not quite Merryweather.
Okay.
No, this is Violet Espadrille. How dare you?
Oh, I'm Violet, right. Violet, she's American. That's right.
It's a little bit much.
Okay. I was like, wait, what game am I playing? And you said you wanted to read old, like, things of interest. Is there anything in particular I can point you to? We do have a archive of all of our past issues. We've been printing since 1899.
Hmm.
Wow.
Quite fascinating.
Well, tribal superstition almost sounds like a good place to start. Sometimes there's a kernel of truth buried among all the superstition.
That has been my experience as well. However, I will only print it if we can verify it. She will take you to the archives and say, any specific year I can help you find, or are you looking for anything in particular as far as...
1919 might be a good year to start.
1919?
That's the Carlisle, right? 1919?
Yes, and that's what actually she just says. Oh, of course, the big news that year was the Carlisle expedition.
What happened to them?
Well, according to the king's rivals, they were all murdered by Nandi terrorists. But there are some who believe otherwise, of course. And she'll pull out, like, a bunch of newspapers and different like clippings and stuff. And so, let's see. Newspaper reports, I will now read you boxed text. Or it's not really box text. It's the newspaper reports from the Carlisle expedition is mounting a trek to confirm data gathered in Egypt concerning the followers of a religious leader who migrated southward into Kenya. While in Nairobi, the Carlisle principal stayed at the Hampton House. The expedition also dealt with Dr. Horace Starrett and Mr. Neville Germain. I will type their names, although I believe in his madness, Clyde ran into Dr. Horace Starrett in the jail.
Yeah. The Reverend Doctor.
The Reverend Doctor. And Mr. Neville German. I don't know. They don't have a pronunciation key. And then there's a photo, and I don't have a clip of this. They didn't provide art for this. A departure photo shows Sir Aubrey Penhew looking exceptionally young, a little younger than you actually anticipated him looking, and Hypatia Masters looking, I mean, the word they use here is dumpy.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's not flattering.
At all. But if, and in fact, it's going to get worse potentially. Can you make me a medicine check, Daisy, Violet?
Oh, I can. I'm sure I'll do
You
wonderfully.
Are fantastic at these. I believe in you.
Yay!
Oh, yay! I finally succeeded in my profession.
So, over your shoulder, Miss Smythe Forbes will be like, many people refer to her as dumpier than her glamorous self. I don't know. It seems a little rude. And then she just walks away, and you look at her, and she's got the signs of being pregnant.
Oh, you know what? Funny thing is, I was thinking that before I rolled the medicine check.
Nice. Yeah, because dumpy. So yeah. Nice. So, it's great writing. So
I figured pregnancy or malaria, you know?
Right. And that is, let's see. Then you find stuff about the discovery of them later. This is much later, obviously. Because they're lost first, and then their bodies are discovered after several expeditions, and actually after Erica Carlisle forces people to go looking for them. The newspaper report gives credit to Lieutenant Mark Selkirk and a squad of men for finding the remains. A later report describes the capture of 5 Nandi who were tried and found guilty for the murders, and an accompanying photograph shows the grisly scene of the men hanging from ropes. So it's a sign of the a photo of the execution. She walks back up behind you as you're looking, and she just says, the Carlisle people were a strange, rather unhealthy lot. In fact, Hypatia, poor dear, was sick some of the time. Indisposed in the mornings, I believe. Yes, Carlisle I scarcely saw. Quite a nervous young man who liked his whiskey. Sir Aubrey, very attractive and virile. And she has sort of a little... but he had dealings with people who were not at all of his station. And I especially recall that Tom Cower, a slimy little woman, was at Hampton House a lot. A mere tea peddler associating with a peer. And she's meaning a peer as in a noble of Britain. She's still in Nairobi. Perhaps she could tell you what they talked about. I'm sure I don't want to know. The Dr. Houston was very aloof. And then she sounds like she got rebuffed by any social gatherings and or interviews. So.
What was the name of the woman that is still around?
Tan Cower. I may not be pronouncing that right.
Okay. And she visited Sir Aubrey at the Hampton House.
Correct.
Is what? Okay.
She is a tea shop owner.
Gotcha. I'm writing a lot of stuff.
Yeah,
down,
sorry.
So.
And none of this was in it. None of this came in one of those nice, sweet, you know, handouts with all of the notes written in it. So. Just a big brain dump.
And going back to what we know of Hypatia, she was like the socialite?
Correct.
She's like
ostensibly there to be a photographer.
Oh, okay, the photographer.
But she really was a debutante socialite. Had been at one point connected with Roger Carlyle, but they had been since just transitioned to being friends. And then Roger Carlyle had then been associated with an African woman.
Right.
And that is who people supposed was his love interest at the time of the expedition. I think that's what you guys know about the party.
Right. So she looked dumpy, was spending mornings not feeling well. So she probably was like in her first trimester, right? Like that's a good assumption.
Yeah, could be.
Okay.
And she'll just keep like trying to like subtly or not so subtly get like news bits from you guys, like where were you last, any news from there that would be fit to print, anything, you know, I've scratched your back, will you scratch mine, you have a good story for me, et cetera, et cetera.
I mean, if you're into the Dodgers, I can probably give you something.
Dodgers.
From Brooklyn.
An American sports team.
I mean, yeah.
No, I don't think that will be read with great interest here. But thank you.
Well, and if you're looking for stuff that is documented, I'm afraid I'm no help. I get all my leads through the spirit world, so I'm just here exploring those leads.
Willing to do a reading for me sometime?
Oh, that would be lovely. I would give that a go.
Excellent. Say maybe tomorrow I have that tea. The next evening, which I'm going to just say is a Wednesday.
Okay. I believe that works for my schedule.
Excellent. Here then, perhaps 7 o'clock.
Okay. 7 p.m.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for coming in. Don't hesitate to buy a copy. Keeps us snake, you know. Okay.
Excellent. All right. Thank you. We'll see you tomorrow evening.
Cheers. Okay. Team Dive Bar. You guys are going to the Loyal Defender. The Loyal Defender Pub. This is every, like, Purdy recognizes this place immediately. This is where people who have shit jobs go to drink right after their shift. This place does not want to be anything else but that clientele's clubhouse. There are no aspirations for anything other than that. Like, come on in, boys, get a cold one. And so when you two walk in, there is a little bit of the record skip because you're not Norm and you're not Cliff and you just walked into this bar where everybody knows your name, but they don't know your name. So it sort of eyes turn and everybody just sort of praising you, and nobody's looking like they're, especially looking at Purdy, nobody's looking like they want to fight, but everybody's super curious as to who just came into the Loyal Defender. Boys ain't from around here, are ya?
I mean, no, but if you want us to leave, we will, but we heard you guys had some, you know, this is the place if you wanted to, like, you know, forget some things.
Yeah, get a cheap drink and some quiet.
Got plenty of both of those things. Saddle up! and he pulls out and he's got whiskey and he's got beer. You want whiskey or you want beer?
Hey, you just leave the bottle here. Can you guys do that over here?
I'll see the color of your coin first, sir.
Got it. Sure.
Yeah, all right. Sees the American dollars go to excellent, and he leaves the bottle. You've overpaid, but there was no way you could pay less.
So, one shiny dollar.
Yep. And so you guys are sitting there with a bottle, and you note there are several people who are, playing cards at tables. At the bar, there are three or four men. Two of them are sitting together, huddled, having a conversation with each other. Another is, looks like he'd been having a conversation with the bartender before the bartender served you, and the bartender's moving back towards talking to that guy. And then a sullen-looking dude who is sitting at the far end of the corner, who is staring at the bottom of his cup of whiskey, and he is nursing the last ring of booze at the bottom of it.
That guy looks like he needs more to drink.
Well, we've got a fresh bottle.
Hey, buddy. What you doing over there?
What's it to you?
You look thirsty.
You offering to remedy that situation?
Yeah, come over here. We just got here. We're just trying to learn the lay of the land. You seem like a talkative sort.
He just grunts and walks over with his glass and sits down next to you and puts the glass right by you.
Pour four fingers.
The eyebrow just shoots up and he goes, "You are a friendly sort." And he just grabs it like a dog that wants to, is shoving out the other dogs from getting the food, moves the elbows in and, so you can't take away the whiskey you just gave him. And he starts sipping the whiskey again, but taking bigger drinks now that he's got a new cup. A fresh cup. Or a fresh amount of whiskey, anyway.
So what's the news around these parts?
Well, you do what the king tells you. You stay in your line. It's not a bad life.
I've been telling you anything you don't like doing, or is it hard to do what he wants, or what?
No.
Seems like you rough job.
It's a boring job. It's been boring for years, but there's been high points. I've been here for 7 years. Long time to be in the same place in the king's service. Guess they don't want to transfer me.
Certainly not everything's boring. I must have had some fun or seen some interesting stuff.
Well, I've seen a couple things over the last... Yeah.
Have you ever seen a warthog?
I have seen a warthog. They're actually not that uncommon around here.
Yeah, everyone keeps telling me that, but I've only seen statues of them. And I'm not. Some of my friends think I'm obsessed, but the thing is that I don't know. They kind of feel like my spirit animal or something.
Huh. Well, I don't know about your spirit animal, but if you're looking to see a warthog with the kind of coin you guys seem to have, you should have no trouble. And he's got a British accent, by the way. I'm just not doing it. You should have no trouble securing a safari. I don't think there'd be any problem with that. And I'm sure if you tell him you want to find a warthog, you'll find one. And he just... But, you want to stay clear. Some of... And I need to check my map here, but you want to stay clear of some of that stuff to the northwest.
It's in the northwest, like Angry Warthogs?
Just
seems likely.
Yeah, I guess. Could be Angry Warthogs. Could just be angry tribesmen, you know. Not everybody here's super happy about the king's men keeping the peace. But
Tori is totally blanking what I asked, what Purdy asked to get here.
As far as
where we thought Nails was, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which I believe he's Italian.
Is Bertram Nails Nelson.
Got it. Okay.
Oh,
right. Okay. Now it's come.
He just keeps drinking and.
What's your name, buddy?
Well, name's Birdie, but everybody calls me Nails. Nails Nelson.
That's a great moniker.
Well, back in the day, I was toughism. But I've let myself go a little bit. But he just starts rubbing his belly.
It's a pleasure to meet you.
Yeah.
We heard your name at another place we were at. We heard them talking about you.
From who? And he gets all like shifty-eyed defensively. From who?
Yeah, nothing bad. I'm not sure. It was a barkeep at the last place we were at. They said you drink a lot. Nothing bad. Just said you. I was drinking a lot, and they said, "Hey, there's only one guy who might be able to outdrink you." And they threw your name.
Well, you always
like when Nails was around. They said,
"Oh." And I'll say whatever the name of that bar was, because I'm sure I made it up.
Gloria.
He's got down to the bottom of his cup, and he looks over at you questioningly as he puts the cup back down.
You realize there could be only one, right? Like, we have to settle this right now. I will not have my reputation besmirched.
There can be
only one.
Let's roll constitution checks.
I'll judge. Have at it, boys.
I'm just joking with you.
Okay.
The bartender told us that this might be a place we were a little bit more. My friend here, he's a little bit more fancy than me. But he said the bartender told me that this might be a place more to my liking for heavy drinking and late into the night.
Yep. Right.
I'm learning the ways, as it were.
Huh. He's doing pretty good. When I met him, he could barely drink, you know, like a soda.
I still now have trouble. It spills right down my front.
I have a drinking problem. Airplane.
So yeah, I think my Purdy's goal,
yeah,
would like ignoring the sort of small talk,
yeah,
but to get him.
He's talking.
Liquored up.
Yeah, he's ready to talk. You've got him into a soft spot. So if you ask him questions, he's gonna answer. So. I think the reason you became aware of him first off was the letters from Jackson Elias. He mentions them, and I don't remember what exactly that would be in the America Carlisle Elias papers, summary of Elias's notes, and Elias ran into Nails Nelson at the Victoria Bar. That's where you went first.
Right. Okay.
And then, Nelson had been a mercenary for the Italians. That's where that came from. On the Somali Abyssinian border, and had escaped to Kenya after double crossing his employers. Nelson claimed to have seen Jack Brady alive in Hong Kong less than 2 years before Elias was in Kenya, and long after the Kenyan court declared that Brady and the rest of the expedition were dead. There we go.
You ever been to Hong Kong?
I have. Have you?
For work? No, not yet. I'm hoping to get there. I didn't. Go ahead.
Yeah, he said there was a time when I could not find work with the King's Rifles. And I did take a merchant marine expedition out to Hong Kong. Crazy trip.
So, I'm gonna be level with you, I promise we had no, we have no bad intentions for you, but we just needed to make sure we'd sort of gotten ourselves in some shit, and an old friend of ours mentioned your name, and we're just trying to unravel quite a bit of stuff. We're hoping maybe we can get your perspective on something.
All right.
So where I wasn't being honest was we came to that other bar looking for you because our friend told us he had seen you there. Our mutual friend, I believe, is a man by the name of Jackson Elias.
Jackson Elias.
He's a writer.
Well, yeah, writer fellow. Nervous. Kind
of. Yep. By the time you saw him, he probably was pretty nervous.
Squirrely. Kept going on. He wanted to know about the Carlisle expedition.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember him.
So, hey, is there anyone in here right now that you don't recognize besides us? I'll say quietly.
He looks around. Nope, these are all regulars.
All right. So,
So you're a little squirrely too, huh?
Well, see, after Jackson did all those questions, he ended up on the wrong end of some sort of weird cult, and he's dead now.
Huh. Well, that's funny.
And we're trying to get to the bottom of it, but it seems like there's a bunch of people, even in this town, who are already aware of who we are and that we might not be interested in their well-being. And we're interested in finding out the truth.
Huh.
So, I don't remember all the details, but our friend Mr. Elias mentioned that you saw someone in Hong Kong who should have been dead.
I did. He's talking about Jack Brass Brady.
Oh, did you know him before he died?
I had only met Jack when they were here in Nairobi, the whole Carlisle expedition. I had met him then. We had a couple drinks.
Were you employed by the Carlisle expedition or just?
No, I just happened to be in Nairobi on a stint with the King's Rifles. I had been doing a tour. Yes. And then when I got discharged that one time and went on the Merchant Marine, I saw him again in Hong Kong, and this is at least 18 months, 2 years probably after the High Court declared him dead. But I saw him living and breathing, and I shared a drink with him in Hong Kong. I can tell you the place. Well, let's see. He was in the Yellow Lily Bar. on Wan Xing Street, which was right near the Causeway Bar, because that's where I started. And then I ended up going into the Yellow Lily Bar, and I saw him there, and it was like I saw a ghost.
Did he mention he thought he was dead?
Did I mention to him I thought he was dead?
I mean, there's newspaper articles written about him and whole court cases. Like, did he know he was dead?
It's a thing you'd expect somebody to know, really.
Well, I mean, you know, he didn't really want to talk to me much, and he definitely didn't want to talk about being dead or anything like that. He just shared a drink with me, and that was it.
He didn't say anything weird or anything? Like,
No, he just he looked like a guy who had, you know, was on a mission.
Did he tell you what that mission was?
No. I had mentioned to him, you know, you look like a guy who's, you know, been given a task by God. And he just looked at me and said, nope, just trying to make my way. But I could tell he was lying. Something was bothering him. I mean, if he wanted, you know, as far as I'm concerned, I don't mind telling people. He didn't tell me not to tell anybody. But on the other hand, if a guy was happy with the world thinking he was dead, seemed to be, then I don't need to be, you know, going to the papers about it. Don't need to. I'm certainly not going to make a case here, because it looks like everybody would love to believe the official story that the Nandies did it. But Jack Bray's not even dead.
So,
or at least he wasn't. He wasn't 4 years ago.
Did he,
or 3 years ago, 3 years ago, because my math's off there, sorry, 3 years ago.
I'm going to ask, just because I believe you had said he had been here for 7 years.
Yeah.
Was that, that's not a...
He's been in and out over the, got it. But mostly seven, he's been mostly hanging out in Nairobi for 7 years. Yep.
Oh. Hey, did he look like a person should look after 2 years of not seeing them, or did he, you know, was he like, had his ear fallen off, or,
no.
You know,
was he all rotting and stuff?
No, it wasn't like he was a dead person walking. He looked like a person who had been incorrectly labeled as dead.
Did you touch him just to make sure he wasn't a ghost, or?
I shook his hand, so.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Was he like cold and clammy, or?
No. I mean.
Yeah, he sounds pretty alive to me too.
Seemed pretty regular.
I won't go there.
I know he was regular because I followed him into the bathroom.
Well, that's the way you gotta. That's how you check.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, if he was dead, man, he wouldn't be pooping. That's for sure.
That's for sure. I mean, but I wasn't that concerned about it because
just the once at the moment, because everybody does at the moment.
Well, yeah, but also I never thought he was. You know, this wasn't. I gotta be honest with you, fellas. Like, you know, the British government will say whatever they need to say to keep the peace. And if they declared somebody dead, they don't want to, and hanged, you know, several people over it. They don't want to
deal. But wait, who were they keeping the peace from? Like, what?
Well, they,
like,
who
was going to be mad if, because it just sounds like a bunch of rich folks went off gallivanting out, like, these guys come out to dude ranches in the West all the time. And, you know, they pay lots of money to ride on a horse, and suddenly the horse bucks and kicks them right in the face. And then a cowhand, you know, gets arrested for it, even though it's the horse's fault.
That's exactly what happened here. But British government doesn't want to deal with that. They don't want to deal with the truth of it, which is something different than what the official party line. Once they said the party line is this, and people were blamed for it, and people were hanged for it, they don't want evidence to the contrary coming up. So I haven't said anything.
Do you have any hunches on what actually happened, or no?
Nah, you'd have to talk to, like, one of the guides, you know, that could take you out. You know, where did they find them? They found them out by, hold on, I've got to give you the name of the mountain. One second, please. Had it, and then I've lost it. One second. It's in so many places, and now I can't remember one place where I know I'll find it. Mount Satima.
How far away is that from here?
There we go. So, he does not have a map, but you guys would have a map. So you are here in Nairobi.
I don't have any tokens with vision on this map.
Oh, yep. Sorry, I keep forgetting that I need to do that.
Thank you. Now I can see. I'm going to Zanzibar. Boom.
Okay. So, you guys are here in Nairobi.
We have a very... Oh, no, that's... I just have a very... Well, got it.
Where did you all go? Sorry. Okay, there.
I'm just moving around so I can see the whole map.
And it's right there.
Yeah.
So, mm-hmm. I am trying to find, like, 100 miles or so.
It's this on the... No, that's Kilimanjaro. Where the hell is this?
Wait, each of those...
North?
Little...
Is it northwest?
Yeah.
Is it where we were told not to go?
Right here.
I'm in British Columbia. Wait a minute. Gone too far.
I've gone too far.
Go to where Clyde is. Clyde's at the mountain.
I ended up in Canada again.
So,
wait, didn't you use a different name for it just a second ago?
Yes, Mount Kenya is not the... It's to the west of Mount Kenya.
Satima, or something
Mount
like that.
Mount Satima.
Satima.
Oh.
Totally different from what I said.
Well, N and an M, maybe? I don't know if I heard it right.
Yep.
Okay.
So, that is, you know... Looking at a map of Kenya at the time, you could take a railroad car farther north, west, or there are guides who would take you. But it's about a little under 100-mile hike.
Yeah.
Several days hike.
Are any of those guides that took the original expedition out, are they still around?
Oh, I would have to think. Somebody's still around.
Or do you know any of the guides that do any of these?
I don't personally. No. I mean, I guess you could check Sam Mariga. He might still be doing it. I don't know that he is anymore.
Do you know where we'd find him?
He's
any guesses?
Yeah, he's in Swahili town somewhere. I don't know it very well. You know, I imagine you'd be able to get your way to finding him. If you go looking for him. That's the only one I would know.
I am perfectly happy to sit here and just drink. We've grilled you enough.
Right on.
I think that's a swell idea.
Okay.
I've got another bot, another dollar burning a hole in my pocket when we finish this bottle.
That's some great whiskey. It's a whole dollar. I don't know in the 20s how much a dollar would buy. It might buy you more than that. I don't know. All right, so I'm going to say that those two interactions took around the same amount of time because Mrs. Smythe Forbes was helping you guys look for stuff. You didn't have to do like a big search. What is it that Team Nairobi Star wishes to do when they've concluded that? I know you guys said goodbye to her and made a date for a couple nights later for doing a seance. But it's probably still, you know, late afternoon, early evening at this point.
Before we leave, I guess I'd have one question with the pictures that we've seen. Was there any, like, symbols, iconography, anything on anyone's possession, person?
No.
Of something we may have seen before?
Nope.
Nope.
1920s photography. Kind of far away, but even looking for anything like that, it's mostly, you know, 6-year-old fashions and of European and American people. No headdresses or any kind of scarification, no amulets or anything of that sort readily apparent.
Well, Miss Violet, seems we figure out quite a bit of information. I guess question is, do we continue on with what we know and see if we can find any of these individuals, or wait for the rest of them?
Well, I don't know. That's a really good question. Are we still inside? Because as soon as we're done, I'm like dropping the southern thing.
Okay. That's up to you guys. If you guys want to walk out, you can walk out for sure. She's gone back to trying to get her paper ready for print for the next morning.
I say we walk out then.
I'm definitely saying that we walk out. Yep.
Okay. Once we're out, though, I do want to tell you what I discovered about Hypatia, about her appearing to be pregnant. I mean, that's something that wasn't in any of the stories.
Oh, is that what she was? I thought she was a little dumpy.
Yeah.
Cigarette?
Nice. Cigarette. Nice.
Oh my goodness. No, that's all right. So the question in my mind would be then, who's the father?
Oh, we're playing this game again.
You play this game often, Clyde?
Well, we did at the bar. We figure out what everyone's story of what they could have been, like that poor Dutchman who could have been on his third marriage.
That's right. That game.
This game, similar thing. I'm going to say Penhew.
I wonder, that reverend doctor that you got to meet, I wonder if anyone from the expedition had a chance to meet with him while they were here.
Well, there's a good chance of that, and I know exactly where he is.
Yep. Oh, you do?
I believe he gave me a card.
Did he seem the type that would gossip about patients, or, well, probably not, huh?
I don't think so. But he does seem like an honest man. Great that I was not of my wits.
I don't know how important it would be, but this just seems like an odd piece of information that didn't make it into the papers. There is a part of me that wonders, what if it's not a human baby? What if it's something else? But, you know.
Like a vampire?
Possibly, I don't know. But I think now my brain goes in all kinds of strange directions because of what we've experienced. I think your assumption might be more accurate.
Oh, I sure hope so. We're going to have a lot of questions.
Granted, it would be helpful to meet that tea shop owner as well. She may be privy to some information about Sir Aubrey.
Be a good idea. I mean, when was the last time you had a, what would you call it, a spot of tea?
A proper cup? A long time.
So which way are you guys heading? That you could...
We could at least just check out the tea shop, huh? Okay. They get to go drink whiskey. We're going to go get tea.
Okay. All right.
Sorry, it's a bum deal for you.
I probably like tea better than whiskey.
I like tea more than whiskey.
It's a good team, then.
It wouldn't be too difficult to find. You know you have to head to the Asian Quarter, where most of the Indian folk live. So actually kind of where Clyde's token already is. Not that map. I'm reactivating this map. All right. So kind of where Clyde's token is already. And with just a couple of inquiries, not only do you hear that it's, where her shop is, but also that it's the best tea cellar in town. It's a small clapboard frame building topped by a tin cupola. It is fairly well known. Like I said, it doesn't take too long for you to find it just asking about Tankar's shop. And it is... let's see. Just about, looks like maybe a one room sort of open front with a kind of going back to New York City, sort of like, and then residences in the back quarters and above. And there is, it looks like it's open for business.
Well, are we looking just to look at the place first and come back tomorrow for questions, or we want to talk to her today?
I will say it's the name of the street is Biashara Street, and I'm only providing that because it's provided to me, so there we go. And there's an alley along the side. Sorry, if you guys do whatever. I just wanted to make sure you knew where you were. So.
Anyone tailing us as of yet? You never know.
Go ahead and make a spot hidden. Robin, what were you going to say?
I was going to answer the question that Clyde asked, but now Daisy's looking around too to see if anyone's...
We are the two least sane members of this party, and we're together in the same place.
I love it when we're together.
Shenanigans are abound.
Well,
ooh.
You don't notice anybody tailing you. You do notice somebody, both of you, with those, notice a person walk into the alleyway along the side. And what catches your eye, both of you would, is this red headband tied into a knot with a flap coming down. You've seen something like it before in New York City.
Sure did, didn't we?
Oh, the tongue thing?
Yep.
Sure is.
Those
fucking bastards are here too.
And they knock, this person walks up, knocks on the side door, waits a second, then the door is opened inward and allowing them in, then the door is shut right behind them.
And it's down an alleyway, you said?
Down an alleyway.
Is it attached to the tea shop or just near the tea shop?
So I'm going to move you guys. Yeah, can you all see Trainish, the map that I just put you on?
It's the rectangle. Yeah, trainish.
Okay, this was my bad train thing for where you guys. Obviously, Purdy and Harmon aren't here. We'll put you over there. And you guys are, well, I'll put you all over here across the street. So this is like, this rectangle that was a train car is now going to be the front of the tea shop. So there's a door right here. Then you saw a person go into an alleyway down here. And right here are more buildings.
So, maybe just because I can't see outside that circle.
Okay. Yeah, I can turn the lights on. lighting, token vision, global illumination. There.
Oh, that's better.
Okay. So where you're standing in the alleyway currently, I mean, not really, but
I don't want to be in the alleyway.
But
no.
I know what you were doing, but that, so that's the alleyway. This is the main street, Biashari Street. And then there are buildings. Actually, we are oriented correctly. So there are buildings to the south and buildings to the north. And there just happens to be this thin air alleyway in between the tea shop and the building to the north. And the alley does appear to throughway out to an alley behind these other buildings.
Okay, so you said this was the tea shop entrance, and
the main
this
door.
Is the door that the guy went in?
Yes, correct.
Okay. So, pretty close to the tea shop.
Could be into the tea shop.
Mm-hmm.
Or the back room of the tea shop. But it is the
right.
same building as the tea shop, for sure.
Well, I was going to suggest we go in and just have some tea, but now I'm concerned. One of those tongue people didn't seem to have noticed us, but...
Yeah.
I prefer to keep it that way.
Hmm. Well, we made it this far. Let's at least see the inside.
All right, if all things go wrong, I'll just stand up and scream really loud, get everyone's attention, we can go run.
Not the alley door, just the tea shop.
I know, but still, the plan. If
yeah.
the tongue guy comes out from the back or something, we just make a lot of commotion and chaos and run.
Works every time.
One more time. I'm referring to us having a spot of tea.
I agree with you. But
yes.
What if the guy with the tongue hat is in the tea shop and sees us? That is why I'm saying...
Oh, you mean? Yeah, I see what you mean now.
Thank
well,
you.
Just do what I do and pretend you're not even there.
All right. That sounds
and like
psychologically
why
healthy, but...
Well, I will grab the nearby newspaper of the Nairobi Star that he has in his back pocket of the article from however long ago. Just here's a beginner lesson into surveillance. Covering the face is a good start.
Okay. So you're kind of you're walking into the tea shop with the newspaper over your face.
No, like you're. You know what I'm, Daisy, that's not how I'm saying it. I'm saying, like, you know, you're sitting down, you're having a pot of tea, just drinking it like this. Kind of like the kid was doing, like that.
Mm-hmm.
Lesson number one.
All right.
Okay. Hold on, I realized I missed a portrait, so... gotta import this quickly. I was just there. I
feel like Daisy never takes anything out of her purse. I have like all this stuff listed, like Trinidad Rizzo's notes that I just never take out of my inventory. So I just imagine like this big purse that I carry around that just has all kinds of crap in it.
Is that the person from Peru?
the dead students.
Nice.
I just think it's funny. Because some, you know how some women do, they just throw everything and then they're trying to find stuff and it's like, oh, wait, no, wrappers and
stick a gum at the bottom.
3 years ago.
A couple of quarters.
We might need paper sometime, you know?
Sorry, I'm uploading quickly. Let's see. Except for it's not as quick as I would like it to be. Because I, it's like there's no way they don't have a picture of her, and then I must have missed it when I was doing this earlier. Okay, save, close, show to players. Okay, this is the woman who greets you at the front counter, and she speaks. She starts off greeting you in English, and just by your dress and appearance, assumes English first, but is heavily accented. Seems to have lost any sort of Near East Indian accent. By maybe dint of having, you hear a lot of different dialects coming out in her voice. She,
because of the tongues, I'm telling you, this is.
Well, she looks nothing but pleasant. Oh, this picture's not great, but she's big smiles and welcome you, and
her tongue's all bloody, but otherwise
asks if you would like some of the, or not some of. A cup of the best tea to be found in Nairobi. And if you like it, she'd be happy to sell you the loose leaf.
Wonderful. Thank you. Let's have some tea.
And she'll start steeping tea for you. And then, and are you new to Nairobi?
Fairly new, yes.
Ah.
Haven't been here long.
Did you travel in by train? Most seem to travel in by train nowadays.
Oh, trains, man. What happened on... We heard a story about a train. Do you remember that?
Yes, I heard the other night a strange fire on the train.
Oh, I was just wondering if that would have been awful to be on a train like that.
Yeah, it did sound awful. I was hoping that you could fill in some details if you were on that train, but apparently not. Thankfully, you were not. You were not harmed in any way.
Yeah, that would put a damper on our trip if we were to have to experience something that terrible.
That's
Oh, this tea is... Did we get it yet? I can't comment on it.
Sure.
There's like a death grip on this teacup right now.
It is wonderful. Yeah, Daisy's trying very hard to be friendly without saying anything of any note. So
sure. She will. Yeah, it's a oolong, it was very fragrant. Delicious.
I'm taking notes about my fragrant oolong tea because that's going to be something the investigators need to know.
Potentially. Who knows? But she's very proud of it.
As I'm making this small talk and my partner is being extremely tight-lipped and not saying anything, I'm also just kind of scanning the room to see if it looks like there's other exits or entrances or other people.
I was going to say the same thing, but you were talking. Like, that's cool. You were doing the channel. I was like, where is the red scarfed man?
Well, then you probably are able to put more attention on it than me because I'm trying to have a conversation without having a conversation.
I don't know. We both went psychotic for the other day, so...
So I have a map. I will open
that's
this map.
That's what scares me. He has a map.
Yeah, that's always a good sign.
No, I don't have a map. I did not apparently upload a map. Oh, nope, I didn't. I didn't upload the map. Okay. So what you see from the door, when you walk in the door, you are, like, it's sort of strange. So, like, the counter L's, I'm going to draw it. As you walk in the door, the counter sort of L's towards you. And so she's serving you. She's standing behind this counter right here. And you guys are in this L shape here. And then there appears to be a hallway. And if, as you casually look, you can see the side alley doorway. And then it looks like there's a room here, and this hallway then opens up into another room in the back. This door in this map, I'm going to change it to be over here. Because that's not correct otherwise. But you can still see it from the, as you walk in. Through this open hallway.
Gotcha. Are there other people having tea?
No, you are the only guest.
You're the only one.
And you do not see your friend who walked in the side door.
Okay.
And do you like the tea?
Oh yes, I had just been saying how this, I can see why we were led to this place and told we just had to come here. This is wonderful.
In my humble opinion, it is the best tea in all of East Africa. I have it.
And so Daisy's mind is like going wild. She's like, oh my God, what did she do to the tea? What's wrong with this tea? What, you know, is there something special about this tea? Like,
I feel like she's got on it. She knows what's going on in the back. She's
right, we're being poisoned. So she's not going to drink it as much. She's going to pretend to be drinking it.
Gotcha.
But not going to swallow this tea anymore.
Would you like to buy any of this tea?
I think we should. Don't you think we should take some? We can share it with our friends. Yes. Would you mind packaging? Do you have some that we can take?
Absolutely.
Like, purchase?
Absolutely. Okay. And she will package up in a small, like, brown paper bag package sort of thing. Some loose leaf tea for you about, she'll ask how much, but you know, you guys are traveling. I don't know, whatever, but you're able to procure tea, and
fragrant oolong tea. Fragrant, that's what's getting added oolong to my gear.
Your gear. All right. And is there anything else I can help you with today?
I don't think so. I think it was just, we just wanted to get, you know, a little bit of a pick-me-up before continuing our day. Thank you so much.
Also, I guess, yep, there's nothing unusual in the shop. Yep, that's it. Sorry, because I was going to read something, and I'm like, oh, that's... Because I thought there was some religious iconography, but there is not. So, okay. Just a very plain wooden-walled shop.
Thanks for the tea.
You're welcome, sir. And then she'll watch you leave. If you leave. Okay.
Yep. Right. That was really useful.
The second we get out the door, I'm going to get everyone's head. Anyone else wearing a particularly red scarf on their head?
All right. Go ahead and give me a spot hidden.
Anyone.
I was like, he needs to get yet another hard. And you did. So as you walk out, you just sort of decide to, like, poke your head around again. And coming up the alleyway from the other direction is another person with the red headband, and they go and knock at the door.
How many knocks? Say a specific number, or just a standard knock?
It seems to be deliberate, like two knocks, but it's not necessarily like a 1-2, but it is not like a, you know, hey, I'm here. You know, it's a knock to get somebody's attention. The door is opened. If you keep peeking, I'm going to need a stealth.
Absolutely.
I'm going to stay.
Yeah, I figured. Okay. Yeah, you're just sort of using your newspaper trick and watching. They don't.
Clearly a mirror in the frame of the newspaper.
No reason for any. You don't believe any reason people would be noticing you there. And that's what you see.
Okay. But like no one out in like the street that would be commonly wearing this similar headdress.
No. It doesn't look terribly odd. There's a bunch of different, you know, headgears and sort of not just headgear, but like, you know, there are Punjabi, there are Sikh, there are different as people are wandering around shopping at this time of day, you see all kinds of different wear, you know, but nothing that's a red, but doesn't like scream out like, you know.
No red flag around here.
As you're looking around, you can understand why it wouldn't necessarily stand out, you know. There's a lot of people wearing a lot of different headgear, or head dresses or hats or scarves, you know, all kinds of accoutrement.
Does this tea shop have a name?
Tan Cars Shop. It's not okay. A particularly great name, but it works for her. Yeah, it doesn't have a great name.
Well, Miss Violet, I believe we find ourselves either in there's a fella in Chicago that Harmon might know more about. And I think they have this thing called fronts.
Oh.
Or like our good old friend
right.
Warhog salesman whose name escapes me. Was also a front of sorts.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's interesting, isn't it, that didn't Sir Aubrey look a lot younger than you would have expected him to look in those pictures?
White.
Right. So, wonder what he got himself tangled up in.
Whatever it is, it's probably worse than what we've been dealing with.
I think we should take this information and share it with the others, and maybe four heads are be better than two in this case. Four heads. Never mind. Let's go.
That makes, I don't know why I think that's so funny, but I do. Four heads. Haha. Let's go.
We're both low on sanity.
The low sanity. I know. It was brilliant.
What are you Robin?
We were just having a lot of fun going insane together.
What are you at right now? What's your current score?
Oh, let's see. I think it's like 30-something.
I'm sitting at 40. You're
I'm at
30?
I'm at a solid 30.
I'm at a solid 40.
Okay. Oh, 30% sane.
Oh.
So, where are you guys heading? Are you heading back to your hotel, or are you rendezvousing? Are you heading to the Loyal...
We were told it was a seedy pub, even yes. Seedier than the other one. Yep. So I don't think Daisy would go back to that pub.
Okay. I feel like it would spoil the oolong tea. We should probably just go back to the hotel and brew some.
Yeah, I want to run some tests and see if there's anything in here other than tea.
Okay.
Show me how to do that.
I am going to check in on our drinking friends. Do they want to continue to drink, or is there anything else you guys want to do? How long do you want to hang out? As night falls, are you planning to drink into the evening?
Well, at some point when Nails goes to the restroom or something, I will ask Purdy, how long do you think we need to drink in order to make it look like that's what we were here for?
I don't think we can go whatever. I do want to ask him if we want to pursue this guide. And I'm not sure. I haven't looked outside to see what time of day it is, but maybe he knows a place we can go drink up in.
Well, I imagine if I
had
$2, I could take a bottle with us.
No. I'm thinking a bar might be the best place to start asking about this guy. This guide, since we don't have... Our other option would be to ask our hotel. I'm thinking just putting feet on the ground up there might be the best way, because less people are going to be involved that we're looking, in case people don't want us talking to them.
Right.
Are you up for a little evening adventure?
Well, yeah.
I won't keep you out too late.
We want some sort of answers, right?
Yeah. Just say, while we're at it, why don't we grab 2 bottles, just in case.
$3, then.
Yeah. 2 would
be. I think, so we'll ask if he knows a bar or someplace we could start asking about this guide.
He's not a lot of bars in Swahili Town. Swahili Town's kind of, I mean, if you've been here long enough, it starts to not feel right. You know?
In what way?
Well, I mean, they were here first, and they're living sort of in the shittiest part of town.
Oh, yes. That's not how I expected you to answer, but understandable.
Yeah. They live on the other side of the railroad tracks, literally.
The wrong side, as it were.
Yes. So, you know, the Europeans are all over to the west and have all their rich private estates, etc. And then to the north is typically where the Asian and Indian population is. And then on the southeast side of the tracks are where the Swahili and Somali towns are. And that's a little bit more, and I hate that I'm going to laugh saying this, but ramshackle. Just from the other game and what happened with that word.
Well, they've got to build their bivouac somewhere.
They do have to build their bivouac somewhere and start a pancake house. But that's where he will say, so not a lot of bars down there, but, you know, I reckon if you go looking for San Mariga, somebody will point you in the right direction.
Let's do it. We're not that far from it, right?
No, because you're up in the central district here, so you're okay. Just going down to here.
Yeah.
And again, not a big place by scale. So
yeah, we'll hire a car if we can. Just down there.
A little harder to hire a car here. You don't have quite the tourist and service towards. But it is only about a mile walk. Okay. The best way to get around is, I will double check what they say here, but basically they were saying this is sort of a beginnings of a capital city, but it's still kind of a provincial.
Sure.
Nairobi is a new colonial town of about 8,000 people. It's pretty high elevation, so every once in a while I'm going to ask for constitution checks. It is relatively segregated, and slums are where most of the African folk live. And that is really all they tell me. But there are 1,000 paramilitary police in a town of 8,000. So that should also tell you something.
They have an odd choice of interpretation of keeping the peace.
Indeed.
Yeah, we'll head that way.
Okay.
Happily with our bottles of alcohol to keep us
insulated on a cold desert evening.
Nails gives you a sort of a salute, thanks for the whiskey, and goes back to contemplating his glass. Doesn't seem like he's planning to do anything else that evening.
When we buy our bottles to take, I will buy another and give it to Nails.
Oh.
Say, it's got to last you the night, so.
This is the best moderation day. It's like the day they brought in those mini muffins to work.
I hope tomorrow is better.
Thank you, sir. All right. It's not too.
Just remember old Clifford Bauer when anyone asks.
Clifford, thank you. Change Harlan to Clifford. Okay. So, we got Isaac, Violet, Clifford, and I don't know if we're sticking with Colt McCracken or not.
No, I was vetoed a couple times in the background for political reasons.
I see.
So,
Listen, if you want to name yourself after all of Sarah Palin's kids, you can.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah, dear.
Is that what's happening?
I will be Braxton Coulter.
Braxton Coulter.
Coulter is better than Palin.
I'm not allowed to be Pistol Trig like Pistol I wanted to be.
And I can be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that Sarah Palin has a kid named Pistol and a kid named Trig.
I know.
I guess it's Bristol. It's Bristol.
Bristol is.
Oh, you're right.
Bristol,
you are right. Yeah.
Bristol Palin, but then there's.
Oh,
also,
yeah, you could have. It wasn't Pistol.
But there is a Colt.
And a Trig.
And a Trig, yeah. So. All right. God. All right. I need a quick mental cleanse.
Focus.
Mental cleanse. Focus. Mental cleanse. Okay.
Would you like to know the world? The ominous after credit scene of Beauty and the Beast 2. With that elf.
Is it really ominous?
It is when I tell them that the director of Taken is going to direct it.
Starring anyway. Liam Neeson as the Beast.
I'm a beast with a certain set of skills.
This is my castle. You're a guest here. A guest who can't leave.
Be my guest. Be my guest.
Put my service to the test.
My service is that yours?
My service to the test.
All
right.
I've never tried to do a Liam Neeson impression. I'm pretty happy with that.
That was pretty good. It was really good. Anyway. Put my service to the test. All right. So you guys don't have any trouble finding Swahili Town. If you go about just, you know, casually, subtly, but still subtly asking for San Mariga, so you are pointing.
It is slums. Are there any prominent buildings?
So it's very easy to see who's starting to do better than whom. The houses that have vegetation. This is actually in the book, that have like reed and broad leaf roofs are clearly not doing well, and they're more like mud adobe hut. And then ones that have actual, like, manufactured roofing, whether it even be made of bits of tin that have been hammered out, those houses have a little more space. They have even a little front yard they've carved out. There's a little bit of sort of making a homestead out of it into something a little bit more permanent and or substantial. But you wouldn't suspect many of these places to have running water any kind of sewer or electricity or anything like that. If you do see one of the things that starts to become clear is the houses that are doing slightly better also have gardens, vegetable and flower gardens. I don't know if, are you planning to ask around a little bit, or are you going to just wander until you hope to find somebody, or how do you want to go about it?
We ought to ask.
Yeah. You're pointed out towards a house that seems to, I mean, it has a solid roof, and it has just overwhelming abundance of flowers growing around it. It's almost like the pride of the block kind of thing. That's the house of Sam Mariga. Somebody points it out to you. And says, yeah, that is Sam's house.
We'll walk up. Knock on the door.
Okay. I want to make sure I get the description right, but it's an African man. I think he's in his 40s. One second.
Well, this name is totally new to us, right? Sam Mariga?
He's actually mentioned in the Elias papers. I will refresh your memories.
I'm in trouble finding.
I just have railway station written in parentheses for his name. I wonder why.
There it is. I found it. Sorry. This paper is summary of last notes.
Because there's a railway that goes north of. You either take the railway somewhat to the direction or you can get a guide. And his name was thrown in.
Yeah. Okay. Because I have him on the list of all, like Neville, Dr. Starrett, Lieutenant Selkirk, and then Colonel Endicott, and then Sam. Like, I had a list of names, and
yeah.
I was like, railway station?
He questioned Sam Mariga at the railway station.
Well, he was once over the line.
Nice. He is, it says, the plantings at his house are lush and brilliant. The house is a humble shack, but it has floral displays that are the pride of Charles Street. That's where you're at. He answers the door. I don't know if I have him as a pick for you guys. I might. I do. Yay. He's probably in his late 40s, early 50s. He just answers the door, and he does speak English. It's not as fluent as others you have met, but he's able to get by. He will say that he's... Can I help you? As he stands in the doorway of his humble abode.
Sir, I'm really sorry to bother you. My friend and I here, we're just asking for a little bit of your time. Probably some to answer, if you don't mind, some questions that you probably answered dozens of times before we're really sorry about that. But the reason it's important to us is our friend, he was by the name of Mr. Jackson Elias. Oh. A short time after, you remember him?
Yes, I met Mr. Elias. Not a ton, but I did meet him. Energetic man.
He was. I'm very sorry to say that he seemed to his research seemed to catch up with him, and unfortunately he was found dead.
As you say, he's found dead. He sort of pushes a little bit past you, looks down both ways down the street, and says, "Come in, please."
Thank you, sir.
That's not spoken of in the open. Hmm?
Have you eaten?
We've drunk, so eating would be pleasant.
I will always say no to that question.
Okay. I will share what I have. And he puts together sort of a vegetarian meal is happy to answer questions. He's, I am sorry that dark things caught up with Mr. Elias. I only spoke with him the one time, but he struck me as what is the word you would use? A champion of justice, of truth?
He was a good man.
He would be proud to know that you saw him that way.
I can tell you what I told him. It's sometime after, you are, I'm assuming, talking about the Carlisle people.
We think more and more that this has something to do with it, although if you have ideas, it wasn't, there's an element of how he died was unusual, and maybe a cult in nature.
Well, people don't come to San Mariga for ideas. They come for gardening. But what I can tell you is what I saw. I was visiting my cousin in the village of Endovu in the Aberdare Forest. None of that will be terribly important. If you want to write it down, go ahead, but I'm not going to type it out. Mariga heard... I had heard how many... I had heard stories of a slaughter in the Northwest. I was curious. I was warned not to go and look, that it was a dangerous place, an unclean place. But I couldn't help myself. I went looking, and what I saw was awful. Bodies shredded, torn apart limb from limb, laying upon ground that was soaked red with blood. And he starts to shudder, you know, like you've seen the horrors yourselves, and you know that he has seen things that you guys have, things similar to what you have seen. I had no choice. I reported it to the authorities. I felt they should know that this had occurred, that there was this carnage. And then a couple of days later, they rounded up a few of the Nandi people and hung them for the crime. I myself am not Nandi, but I don't understand how they could have ripped people into shreds like that. It was, I don't even understand how a tiger could do such a thing. A tiger, I'm so, not in the right place for that. Lion could do something like that.
Liger.
Liger, yeah, it was a white liger. He stops talking as you ask.
Are you saying that, like, when you say they were shredded and that you can't imagine, are you saying, like, you don't think, like, knives or machetes or anything, like, they were much worse than that?
Have you seen what happens when raw meat is pressed through a grinder?
Yes.
It's strips of body, as if it were flayed and pushed through and separated.
Oh.
That is unpleasant.
The bones were broken and ground up inside. And he starts to, you know, seize up a little bit there.
Can I ask? I mean, I you've already told me, I think, the answer to this question, but since you were there, I'm not expecting that you poked around and looked, but that almost makes it sound like there's no way anyone could figure out who the dead people were.
No one comes to Sam Mariga for his ideas or his thoughts on such things, but two things bother me, friend. One is I don't know how
nuclear war.
Anyone nuclear war, and the other
carnies. Circus folk.
Small hands, you know. Anyway, smell of cabbage. The two things bother me. One is I would not know my mother in that carnage. And the second is, if this was the Carlisle expedition, why had no animals eaten this? This had been months. Why were their bodies unspoilt, such as they were?
So you're saying you saw them a while after. Sorry, I missed that point.
Well, it looked to me like it could have been the day before. But if it was the Carlisle expedition, it had been months. I was here in town when they came through.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's some people saying that they've seen members of that expedition, but after, you know, that they weren't the ones to die, which is a tragedy because that means innocent people might have been hung.
Indeed.
I'm pretty sure innocent people were hung based on what you just said.
Yes, I agree. I've always thought that there's just no way the tribesmen, they don't possess the strength. No human possesses the strength to do that to a body. Of course, nobody comes to Sam Riga for his understanding of biology. Well, I hope you're... He spoons out more food if you want any more.
Do you know of any guides? And I don't know if you would be willing, who would take us to that area.
You are also looking for justice, for the light, for making things good.
Yes, we're looking to find whoever did this to our friend, and try to understand what happened, because it's not, I think, in our months of travel now, it just gets more and more confusing. And I'm the stupid one, so. But we would very much like to. We know that's what our friend would do, is look for the truth to this. If it happened to any of his friends, we'd like to honor that.
I hate to ask it this way, but I would be missing some work. Would you be able to compensate me for... I will take you, but would you be able to compensate me for the work loss?
Absolutely.
Of course.
Then,
and if there's things we could do to help with the work, we can... I got some big shoulders I can help out with if you need.
Indeed you do.
Some assistance.
Then I will take you. Give me a few days to... make things right with the... I work at the rail yard. Let me take
is a... that
few days
ago. Is that where our friend met you?
Yes. Yes. He tracked me down to the railway station. I'm the gardener there.
Do you know? Did he tell you how he found you?
I guess he heard from Lieutenant Selkirk that I was the one who had run into the bodies.
Got it. So. Well, thank you. This food was delicious. Best thing I've eaten since I've been here.
Oh, well, I'm your humble servant. I'd be happy. I'm going to say Thursday is when he'll be ready to go to take you guys.
We'll be in touch. We have two more of our companions with us. We just have to make sure everything works out. And otherwise, if something changes, we'll let you know. Otherwise, we'll coordinate for Thursday.
You've got it. Sounds good.
Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And he shakes both of your hands and waves you out and gives you both some of the flowers from the garden. He's like,
lovely.
Yeah. You know, if you're looking to impress anyone, because tell them Sam Mariga grew it. And that's it. That's what he has to say. So, I'm going to flip back over to Team T.
He didn't even ask for that extra bottle of whiskey. I guess we get it.
He didn't seem to be into the whiskey drinking. Didn't seem to be the sort.
These bottles will make great vases, too.
You can put flowers in them.
For our flowers.
That's right. Team T, you were heading back to the room, and there was going to be some sort of botany experiment.
Well, maybe chemistry or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to see if there's any identifiable. If it seems like if it's just tea, or if maybe it's laced with something, or... I don't trust anything anymore. I'm a little jealous. I'm not jealous because I don't know the conversations the other guys have had, but, you know. had a better night meeting with nice people than we did. So.
What kind of things do you think they could put in the tea that could, like, you know, mess with us?
I don't know. Hallucinogens?
Arsenic?
Maybe. I don't
like
know.
Like what?
Something. Terrible things, I'm sure.
Visine?
Oh, so you have to use the bathroom rule? Yeah.
Is that what happens?
They'll never leave their hotels again.
What?
Don't drink Visine.
They've taken that ingredient out.
Wait a minute.
No longer is true, but it was.
Don't
drink old Visine.
That sounds like an altruism, but wait, what? What happened to you if you drank Visine?
You poop a lot. If you could put like two drops of Visine in someone's drink,
and it would give them the trots. Oh,
Do you feel like you have the trots right now?
I feel like as a former dean of students, I should have known that one.
in the 80s is when this
changed. Yeah. I wonder how I don't do stuff like that.
I didn't either, but I was responsible for finding people who did stuff like that. That's really funny. Okay. And it's only the old
Visine. Did not know about that.
Okay. Well, that's one to grow on. Okay. So, what kind of check do you want to do?
I don't know.
Sanity.
I mean, I imagine... Shut up. It's not insane. You weren't there. You don't.
Any
you don't
science
know how bad it was.
If you use medicine, I'll be looking for a hard success.
Well, I have biology and chemistry background as well, so.
Okay.
I mean, I'm better at biology, but I feel like this is more of a chemistry.
I think it's probably more of a chemistry thing. Yeah.
So.
Okay.
I will roll chemistry.
So what is that leaf there? You know that
I'm
was a little
use
different.
Some luck because I have a 66 in chemistry, and I want to get it to a success. So I'll use five to get it there.
You can. You are very certain that this is just tea. But
are you really?
What are the rules? Did we make a rule? Like, if you use luck, do you still get to put the X in, right? So I mean, at least you get to.
I believe that is your house rule.
The house rule, right? So at least you'll get to reroll chemistry.
Okay.
Because you had a success, so you'll get to. Add, I mean, you'll get to do it on investigator development.
Awesome.
So
the good news is, it does seem like all we had was tea, so that's good.
Great.
I was a little worried.
But now comes the question: if she's a front.
Oh. You said you saw another one as we were leaving. She has to be. Something no good was going on there.
Something's going on there.
Tongue people.
It's the Juju house all over again. I remember the name. It's been so long.
Oh, the
Juju house. It felt like years. But it's only been like 3 months.
It's time for us to burn something else down again?
I'm going to say, because we are going to end in 15 minutes, for Cory Pumpkin time, that you guys walk back into the hotel at this point so that you guys can all investigator confab.
We found the murder cult. We found them.
You come in and she's got like 10 different cups of tea yeah. with different things.
There's a board.
Just happened.
Everything's crossed out.
Yeah, just yarn and litmus tests everywhere.
Purdy, you're not going to believe this. Those fuckers are here too. We saw them. Those guys who got Elias, they're here.
Well, we had a lovely dinner.
Oh, we brought you some flowers, Daisy.
Oh my goodness.
And we'll, I guess we'll just sort of explain what, like, that we sort of made plans, you know, for us to see the site and just explain everything.
Oh, I'm glad it's not till Thursday. I have to do a psychic reading Wednesday night, so that'll work perfectly.
You might, this gardener, though, he seems to really know his stuff. If you want to save some of that tea, maybe he can.
I think I'm reasonably certain it's just tea, but it was really good tea, and when we saw the bloody tongue people walking into the building, I just didn't know for sure. I had to test it.
He could probably grow you more of it.
We have two nights before Thursday, right? We'd say it's Tuesday.
Right, because I said two nights until, you know, one night she is busy, then the next night was Wednesday.
Oh, so we have three nights before
Thursday. Three nights to Thursday, because tomorrow night nothing. Well, no, two nights, right? Tomorrow night nothing. The next night is Wednesday when you're doing the. Yeah. Okay. Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry. So it's Monday. This woman had nothing on Tuesday. Then Daisy is doing a séance. Then Thursday.
Right.
So three days. yeah, reading. Right.
Maybe a tea leaf reading. Oh, I have plenty of tea.
Yeah. That could work.
Yeah, so we could try to scope out that shop and see what's in that door one of these nights.
I think that would be a good idea, because whoever that lady is, she was very closely connected with Sir Aubrey, I believe, in this very building, because we're staying at the Hampton House Hotel as well, right? So when they were staying here, that was when they met.
Yeah. I forgot you guys were in the Hampton House.
Mm-hmm.
So then, then you would know that the proprietor's name is Reggie Baines.
Is it public knowledge that amongst the group that you have been trying to contact spirits?
I haven't been hiding it.
So then I think Purdy would be like, have you thought about trying to talk to one of the Carlisle expedition?
No, I actually have only been trying.
I know one of them's alive, so that one won't work.
Right, right. That's a really good question, Purdy. I've only really tried to contact people that I've known.
But I mean,
it's hard. It's really difficult.
Yeah, you know, I'm just thinking that, like, maybe if we had an object or something of theirs, or would that help?
Oh, or maybe when we go to the, well, we're assuming that they weren't killed on that site, though, right?
But maybe you could talk to the people who did die there.
Yes,
whoever they are.
I think that would probably be, you know, easier. Because
we need to make sure
too far from there. Usually, when there's a traumatic death,
it's good to aim for people who are dead.
Right.
Yeah, I think I don't know. We need to make sure you're okay with that and that you are doing it safely, because I can only imagine now that is gonna be not a good thing if you're touching into something that.
Oh, right. Like when Clyde killed.
Yeah, we got it. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, we already know. That's, yeah. It could be a very dangerous.
What did Clyde do this time? Do you want me to get rid of him? I mean, he could be out of here in like 3 seconds.
No. I don't think it was intentional. I just sent Clyde to, you know, my psychic, and she ended up dead. That's all.
Yeah.
But it's not his fault.
You know that?
Well, I would hope it's not your fault.
Okay.
Good night. All
right. Right. So we could tell you, too, about how Sir Aubrey looked quite young and virile in the picture, and that Hippolyta was dumpy and pregnant.
Some of that virile comment comes from a clearly enamored Miss Smythe, so you know, you might not have from a 1920s photograph called him virile, but definitely Natalie Smythe Forbes found him to be.
Mm-hmm. And you, so had, Sir Aubrey was,
I believe, had heard this. Oh no, you did not. Yeah, Penkew was the virile one, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Got it.
Right. Yes, and so we'll share how Sir Aubrey also had the, you know, whatever, contact with the tea shop owner. Yep. We already talked about the tea shop, and
the fact that they stayed here. You found that out, too.
Maybe share our theories about who the, yep. Mm-hmm. Oh. So those are the pieces that I remember.
Yeah, I think
you. So who should we, like, we have full day, like we have 2 full days before Thursday, right? Or
yep.
Mostly 2 full days.
Yep.
So who should we talk to next?
Well, some names I have written down is, when I was locked up, there was a lovely, I wouldn't call him a doctor of sorts. I'm more of a religious type man. By the name of Horace. Apparently, he also met with the Carlisle expedition. He's been more like a reasonable man.
Yeah, he might know more about the pregnancy. But it would be trying to get him to talk, I think that would be difficult.
And then there was another individual, which I believe Elias mentioned before, A. Germain. I can't find his first name at the moment in time.
Neville,
yes. Perhaps another person we also could talk to is them.
I do like your idea of checking out the tea house. Something's going on in there. And we know the Bloody Tongue are up to no good.
Right. Let's just not get too on their radar.
It's a little late for that. I
mean, we could just burn the place down.
Like, that's what I said.
We know they're very much on the radar.
Would it be
first
worth
it? We steal the tea you like, as much of it as we can put in our pockets, and then we light the place on fire.
But then we're walking away with evidence. If we burn the tea, it's not only fuel. Then we're not leaving with evidence. No, we probably should find out what's going on before burning the place down.
Would it be worth our time to go visit the not the mercenaries? What's their group called? The King's something.
The King's Rifles.
The King's Rifles.
Sounds like that name came up a bit with you guys.
Did you see any warthogs in that tea shop?
You did not.
I did not.
Maybe. There was a very bushy bearded man in there.
I saw you guys, or I heard you guys. I know you two. You look around and you study everything very intently.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just remind you, the last time we saw the Red Tongue, there were warthogs, a lot. One would say manufactured pieces of priceless art. So maybe it's the warthogs that's behind all this. That's all I'm saying. Just keep your eyes open.
On our list of theories.
We heard they live here in this country.
Somewhere
in fact,
down
to the northwest, the worst ones are to the northwest.
Well, it sounds like we'll be going on a safari then.
That does sound like it. Just because there's one name, like I was going through as you guys were listing off the people, there's one name that I think figures prominently in the Elias notes, or if it's not prominently, it would have come up by Corydon, and I didn't maybe emphasize it enough, but Johnstone Kenyatta is another name that came up a couple times, so I don't want it to get buried, because some of that's all the way back to New York.
Yeah, it does sound like a familiar name.
Oh, he says, interview with Johnstone, who says that the Carlisle murders may have been performed by the cult of the Bloody Tongue.
Oh, yeah.
He says that the cult is based in the mountains, and its high priestess is part of the Mountain of the Black Wind. Did we figure out what the Mountain of the Black Wind is? For instance, the mountain that we want to go to?
Yes, we'll do some research on that while we're here.
But I just didn't want you to lose sight of that one, because I know that he has his own paragraph in the notes.
All right.
And I would assume you guys would have reviewed the notes.
Our homework for 30 minutes before the next game is to read those notes again.
That sounds about right.
So that they're fresh in our mind.
30 minutes after we start.
30 minutes after the game's over.
That's right. All right. Well, I think this is as good a place as any, because if we did go further, we would be getting really late. Because things will take off very quickly from here. So our first stream in forever. Thanks for playing, everybody. Glad we could finally get back together to play a game. And for those hanging out in the chat who are not bots, which is crazy, thanks for hanging out with us tonight. Also the bots, I for one am looking forward to our robotic overlords. I really am looking forward to, as soon as we're done with this stream, to find out the downbeat ending to. Because where we left it originally was Beauty and the Beast had life lessons and learned the power of communication and transparency.
I just asked it what the post-credit scene would be. And it was a little too, it didn't lead to a natural sequel.
Beast dies.
So I said, could you make this a little bit more ominous?
I can't wait to find out.
Although you do really need to the scene about the dress. You do need to read it, because it's really funny.
I'm looking forward to it. But until the next time, which is actually tomorrow, so rains pours, but we'll be back on tomorrow night with Warbler Brothers. We're starting a new... No, we're in the middle of one.
We did start.
We did start. We're in the middle of a new adventure, and see if the Warbler Brothers can actually get a paid gig. And then after that, we'll be here next Sunday with Against the Giants. So, until then, roll some dice, play some games, and give of your time or treasure to things that are meaningful to you. Have a good night, y'all.
Good night.